Hey, what's up YouTube? I am back and today we are talking about how to make your GoPro footage look super professional and cinematic. And there's a bunch of things that we have to go through. First of all, I show you guys how to set up the GoPro for that color grading process in order to make that footage look cinematic. And in the second half of the video, we jump over to Final Cut Pro, where I essentially show you guys how I edit my videos. First of all, I'm not a professional color grader, so there are things that I may not do the right way. If that's the case, please let me know because I'm always willing to learn. But otherwise, I hope this video is helpful. If it is, give it a thumbs up because it helps me and helps the channel grow. Leave a comment, or no, even better, share it so we can grow our community. If you're interested in the LUTs that I'm using, there's a link in the description below. Click on them. I hope you like them. If you do, then thanks in advance for supporting the channel in that way. And with that, let's jump right into the video. Let me show you guys how to set up the GoPro. So let's get started. Let's turn on our GoPro. Let's go into video mode and here we see the different profiles. Let's choose the profile cinematic because whatever changes we are making, you can save them and you can keep them for your future video shoots as well. When it comes to resolution, I barely shoot in 4K because with the GoPro, I actually don't need that much resolution. However, 1080p, in my opinion, can be a little restricting, so 2.7K is a good compromise. First of all, it gives you enough resolution for post-processing, so if you want to stabilize your image or crop in, so you have enough to play with. And 4K can be sometimes a little too much for the limited bitrate that the camera has. So if you want to pull and push and color grade the footage in post, you want to have enough video data per frame. So 2.7K in high bitrate is a good compromise and usually what I'm going for. So when it comes to frame rates, I usually shoot in 24 frames per second. Why? Because Hollywood movies always were and still are shot at 24 frames per second. So if you want to go for that cinematic look, you want to shoot in a frame rate that people associate with, you know, sitting in the cinema and watching a Hollywood movie. And that is 24 frames per second. It looks a bit choppier than 30 frames per second or 60 frames per second. But yet again, here in this instance, we are going for that cinematic look. So 24 frames per second it is. So just in case you want to shoot in slow motion or slow down the footage, you can also shoot in 120 frames per second, which gives you enough frames to slow down the footage 5 times. 24 frames per second times 5 is 120, so enough frames there. However, in 120 frames per second, you can only use the field of view wide, which is fairly wide and it induces a fisheye effect or barrel distortion, which can be distracting when you're going for that cinematic look. So let me show you how that looks like. So as you can see, with 120 frames per second, you get very smooth slow motion. However, on the left and right hand side of the frame, there are essentially no straight lines. So depending on what you're shooting, you can get away with it, but usually that is something that people try to avoid, especially when you're going for a cinematic look, which should be a little bit more closer to real life. So a good compromise is to shoot in 60 frames per second, which gives you enough frames to slow down the footage 2.5 times. Still a very nice effect, but at least with 60 frames per second, we can avoid that fisheye effect by choosing linear mode as our field of view. We'll have a look at it more in just a second, but when it comes to cinematic look, we want to have our footage resemble more real life and not have any distortion. Most of the time, however, I go with 24 frames per second, so let's choose this for now and let's move on and let's have a look at the field of view. And as I said earlier, wide introduces a fisheye effect, which I usually try to avoid, so I go with linear. In linear mode, the GoPro applies software correction for that fisheye effect or barrel distortion, which makes it much easier in post-processing, because getting rid of that fisheye effect in post can be very tricky sometimes. So in order to, you know, make it as easy as possible for me, I try to stick with linear as much as I can when shooting for that cinematic look. Hyper smooth I usually keep turned on because I like smooth footage, and since I have the GoPro Hero 8 Black, I don't have a gimbal with me all the time, and the rest of the features that you see here I usually don't touch. So let's have a look at ProTune, the advanced settings of our GoPro that gives us more control over the look of our final footage. And the first thing that we want to do is set the bitrate from standard to high, which means we have up to 100 megabits per second for our 24 frames per second, which means it's more image or video data or information than with standard, that gives us a better image quality, which is absolutely needed if we want to process the image in post-production. The shutter speed I usually keep at auto and let the GoPro decide what shutter speed to choose for the current shooting scenario. If you want to set the shutter speed manually though, the rule of thumb is the shutter speed should be twice of your frame rate or closest to. Which means in our scenario, since we are shooting in 24 frames per second, the shutter speed should be either 48 or 50. When it comes to exposure value compensation, however, that is something I usually play with. Exposure value compensation allows you to fine-tune your exposure to the darkest or brightest parts of your image. So for example, if the shadows are too dark underexposed, then you can increase exposure value compensation. If the brightest parts of your image, the highlights, are clipping, then you can bring exposure value compensation down. And that is usually what I'm doing, especially when shooting in bright daylights, because the GoPro tends to clip the highlights, especially when it comes to a cloudy sky. But that is something that you have to adjust when it comes to your current shooting scenario. I usually go with either -1 or -0.5. So now let's have a look at white balance. And white balance is probably one of the most important settings here for our case, because we are after a certain look, a cinematic look, and white balance sets the color tone of our video footage. Now, if you're a beginner when it comes to color grading, which I assume most of you guys are, I would strongly recommend to set the color tone or the white balance manually. That gives you a much easier time when it comes to color grading in post-production, but still a lot of control over the final look of your image. So for instance, in bright daylight, you can go with 5500, otherwise set the white balance to the closest to what the final image should look like. Now, if you're experienced when it comes to color grading and you know what you're doing, you can also go with native. Native is only a minimally processed footage that gives you the most flexibility in post-production. It needs a little bit more care, but again, more flexibility in post. So essentially go with whatever you feel most comfortable with. Now next, let's have a look at the ISO settings. An ISO determines the sensitivity of your image sensor to light. The higher the ISO, the more sensitive the sensor, the more it can capture in low light conditions. This being said, the higher the ISO, also more noise is being added to the image. So setting the ISO is always a balancing act between the low light capabilities of your camera and how much noise you're willing to accept in your footage. Now, I prefer a cleaner to a brighter image, so I usually leave the minimum ISO at 100, but I set the maximum ISO to the lowest I can given the current lighting scenario I'm in. So when it comes to bright daylight, I bring the ISO down to 200, sometimes 400. When it gets a bit darker, then I bring it up to maybe 800, but not beyond this, because especially if you want to do a little bit more with our footage in post-production and color graded, we really need a clean image. So 800, in my opinion, is the highest I would recommend. So when it comes to sharpness, I say it all the time, high is way too high because it's too much detail and makes the footage look almost unnatural. So medium is usually a good compromise, but since we are doing so much in post-production any which ways and we can add sharpness in post super easy, let's go with low. Now we're almost done with setting up our GoPro, but last but not least, let's have a look at color profiles, and there are two to choose from. GoPro and flat. Now GoPro gives you an already processed image with a lot of contrast, a lot of colors, which is great if you don't want to do anything in post-production and not color grade your footage. But since we want to get the most control over the final look of our video and do the color grading ourselves, we go with flat. Now flat is a more neutral color profile that has a wider curve, which means it captures more information in the brightest and darkest parts of your image. Less contrast, less colors, that gives you more control and flexibility in post-production, because essentially you can add more contrast and saturation to your liking. Hence, it puts you in control of the final look of the video and not the GoPro. So flat it is. So this is it. This is how I set up my GoPro when it comes to achieving that cinematic look, and I plan to color grade the footage in post. The rest of the settings are not our concern at this point. So essentially we are done. So now that we've set up our GoPro and I hope you guys shot some video, let's jump over to Final Cut Pro. Let me show you guys how I edit my videos, how to make the footage look cinematic. Now in Final Cut Pro, we create a new library, an event and a project as we would normally do. As a resolution, we choose 1080p, even though we shot in 2.7K, because 1080p in most cases is all what we need. And as a frame rate, we choose 23.98 frames per second, which is essentially it's 24 frames per second. The rest we keep as it is, and let's click OK, and let's start editing. So after you imported your clips, you would drag them onto your timeline and start editing. In order to not get it too cluttered and keep it obvious, I dragged only one of the clips here to the timeline. Now, in order to start color grading our clips, we would go into the effects panel or effects library. Under color, there is that effect color board. We will take it and drag it onto our clip, which gives you a new option or new item in our inspector, which is called color board 1. Now, once you click on that colorful icon here, you get control over the color, the saturation and exposure of your clip. This being said, you would need to do this with every of your clips. So let me show you how to work more efficiently. In order to apply a color grade to multiple clips at the same time, you can apply the color grade to an adjustment layer, and all the clips that live below the adjustment layer essentially inherit that color grade. So you just one color grade, and then you can, you know, apply it to a bunch of different clips. Now, unfortunately, unlike other video editing programs, Final Cut Pro does not come with the functionality of adjustment layers. This being said, they're being installed very easily. There's a link in the description below. Follow the instructions and then you can, you know, use adjustment layers as well. I also recommend to use two adjustment layers at the same time. So you can apply the base grade, which is the basic exposure, saturation, and some minor white balance adjustments to one adjustment layer. And then your artistic color grade, essentially the one that makes your footage look cinematic, on a second adjustment layer. So that gives you a bit of separation and control, and more importantly, oversight of your color grading process. Now let's make ourselves a bit more room, and then let's go into the effects library or effects panel and drag a color board effect on each of our adjustment layers, and then let's start color grading our footage. I use the adjustment layer at the bottom for my base grade. Now let's click into the inspector and let's start color grading. From left to right, we can now adjust the color, the saturation, and the exposure of all the clips that live below this adjustment layer. Now, before we do anything though, I highly recommend to turn on video scopes, because it gives you way more control over what it is that you're doing when it comes to color grading. Now, video scopes are a visual representation of the numeric values of your clip or frame that you're currently looking at. Now, in Final Cut Pro, we have three types of scopes. First of all, waveform or luminance or luma, which is the amount of gray in each pixel from very light to very dark. Then we have the vector scope or chrominance or chroma, which is the hue or color of each of the pixel. And then we have the histogram, the RGB levels, essentially the ranges of waveforms and vector scopes in an image. It sounds complicated, but it isn't. Let me show you how it works. Now on the left hand side, we see the luma waveforms. Again, it's a luminance representation of the image of the right hand side, with white being 100% and black being 0%. Everything sits somewhere in the middle, with the highlights in 100% to 66%. The midtones or mids are sitting between 66 and 33%, and the shadows between 33 and 0%. Everything that goes beyond this, either over 100% or below 100%, is essentially lost image information. So you want to make sure that you don't push the image above 100 or below 0%. So just by overlaying the image, I think it becomes a bit more clearer. Now, when you look at this, you can now see where the highlights are, the sky here on the right-hand side. Then you see where the fonts are, in the sign here on the left hand side, which are almost white, and then the gray tissues. And being gray, or the tissues, is something that we will be using for essentially adjusting our color grade. But again, look at how the image corresponds with the waveform. Essentially, this is how you would read the waveforms. Now, when it comes to adjusting the color though, we switch over to the RGB parade, which is almost the same thing, but now we are looking at the red levels, the greens and the blues separately. There's one thing to remember: the same amount of red, green and blue results in a neutral color, so a shade of gray if you will. So you want to identify the parts of your image, of the frame on the right hand side, that you want to be a neutral color. So that could be the tissues, for example. And then you need to identify that spot in the RGB parade and adjust the greens and the blues and the reds in a way that, yeah, it's being leveled. It's the same waveform, if you will. For adjusting the colors, you can either adjust them across the board, which would be master, but you can also adjust them separately for the shadows, for the midtones, and for the highlights. In order to do that base color grade, I usually start with the midtones, which gives you the most impact, and then I fine-tune with the shadows and with the highlights. So again, the idea is to spot that part in your image that you want to be a neutral color. So you need to level that spike within the waveform on the same levels across the reds, the greens, and the blues. That could be the tissues, that could be something else that really differs, you know, by image and by frame. But the result should be the most natural looking or most to real life looking image possible, because at the end of the day, whatever it is that we want to do artistically with that shot, we'll do with the second adjustment layer. Now this looks already really good, and depending on whether you've set your white balance to native or manually with a Kelvin value, there's more or less to be done, but essentially this looks good to me. So the next step is to adjust the exposure. You can either switch back to the Luma waveforms, or we can just do it here real quick in the RGB parade, but here you want to adjust the highlights and the shadows to make sure that everything that you see is between the 100 and 0% mark. And then within that area, we want to make sure that the midtones sit between 33 and 66%. So adjust it in order to end up with an exposure that you like the most. Now you can also adjust the saturation, but if you want to have your entire movie a bit more saturated or less saturated, I would make these adjustments in the second adjustment layer when it comes to that artistic look. But if you use different clips from different cameras and one is more saturated than the other, then you can make here that slight adjustment here as well to get them essentially on the same level. So now this is it. This is our base color grade that we've done for either the clips individually or for entire scenes. Now we want to add that artistic or cinematic look, which we are adding with the second adjustment layer, either for the entire movie or just for different scenes again. So you would be doing this by grabbing another color board effect and drag it to the second adjustment layer and start doing essentially the same thing, but now adding that artistic look that you're after. Now this can be super fun, but at the same time very frustrating, because you could spend hours if not days on trying to find or create a certain look, but if you don't have that experience, it can be very hard to achieve. So I recommend to work with LUTs. Now LUTs are probably the quickest way to grade your footage once you've color corrected what we just now did. So what are LUTs? LUT stands for lookup table, and in the context of color grading, a LUT transforms the color input values from your camera, from the original footage, to your desired output value from the final movie or the look of the final movie. So hence, you can think of a LUT almost like an effect that you can apply to your original footage in order to make it look a certain way. Think of it almost similarly like an Instagram filter or a filter that you know from your photo editing software. Now LUTs can be found all over the internet. Some are for free, most you have to purchase. If you like the look of my videos, then the ones that I created, you can get them following the link in the description below. Now let me show you how to apply them. Now instead of applying the color board effect to the second adjustment layer, we find the effect custom LUT and apply it to the second adjustment layer, which essentially is a LUT loader that allows you to pick and choose a LUT from your hard drive and again apply it to the adjustment layer so it affects your movie. For that we go back into the inspector. Here you see a new field, custom LUT. Under LUT at the moment it says none, so we click on this. At the bottom of it you can say load custom LUT, click on this as well, and then you have to navigate into the folder of your hard drive where you downloaded your LUTs to. Here you see the LUTs that I created, select them all, press open, which essentially loads the LUTs now into the LUT loader, and then you can pick and choose the LUT that you like the most here for your particular movie. In my example here, I'm going with Cinematic 1. And now, as you can already see, with just a click of a button, we added a very filmic cinematic look to our footage, which in my opinion looks awesome. It works really well with that particular scene. If the effect comes in too strong, you can adjust the mix and lower the intensity. But otherwise, I would recommend to go back into the base adjustment layer and make some minor adjustments, just to make sure that, you know, if some of the colors are a bit off, that you can adjust it, but mainly look at the exposure. So if the effect maybe, you know, clips the highlights or crushes the shadows, then this is your chance to make these adjustments to essentially make this clip or the movie look really good and make your original footage work with the LUT that you've chosen. Now this looks good. I'm super happy with the outcome. Now if you want to really sell that cinematic look or effect, what you can also do is add a letterbox effect. It's not necessarily everyone's taste, but essentially what it is the black bars at the top and at the bottom of the frame, which then makes your footage look as if it's shot in a different aspect ratio in CinemaScope, for instance. So in order to do that, just go back into the effects library, choose the effect letterbox and drag it over to your actual clip. And why you want to do that, I'll explain in just a second. Now you'll find a new effects panel in the inspector, which is called letterbox. And the first thing that we want to do is change the aspect ratio. There are a bunch to choose from. I would recommend to go with 2.35 to 1, which is wide, but not too wide, so you don't lose too much of your scene. Now, most importantly, you want to adjust the offset, which means the positioning of your video footage within the new frame. And that can be different from shot by shot. That's why I apply that effect to the original clips, because what I'm doing now, I would be going through the entire timeline, check every individual clip and adjust the offset to make sure that everything looks perfect, which essentially it's the final step of my editing process. So this is finally it. It was a long video, but I hope it was helpful. Now let's have a look at what we created together. So this is it, my friends. This is how I shoot video with my GoPro and edit the footage in Final Cut Pro to make my videos look professional and cinematic. And I hope this video was helpful. If it was, give it a thumbs up because it helps me and helps the channel grow. Any questions or anything that I haven't addressed in today's video, leave a comment down below and I'll get back to you. Most importantly, if you want to see more of myself and this type of content, subscribe to the channel and hit that bell icon so you get notified when I'm uploading new videos. If you're interested in the LUTs that I'm using, there's a link in the description below. Follow the link, check them out. If you purchase them, thank you so much in advance for, you know, supporting that channel in that way. And with that, as always, I'll catch you guys in my next video. Bye.